Vancouver, Mount Pleasant.
Thank you, Honorable Speaker. I am indeed honored to be able to speak to Bill 3, the Discriminatory Provisions Historical Wrongs Repeal Act. I've just been so fascinated with all of the comments made by members from both sides of this House, speaking about discriminatory laws that were created in this province, created in these chambers, and now are going to be shelved in the name of human rights and justice. I have a lot of thoughts, Honourable Speaker. As you are aware, I am an Indigenous woman. My grandparents are Niskan, Gitxsan, Cree, and Ojibwe, French and Scottish. There's been lots of dialogue around the importance of multiculturalism in this country and where the First Nations have stood in this country. There have been mention of colonization in these chambers. There has been lots of talk about segregation. So I just want to start with my remarks by lifting up my hands to the member opposite for bringing forward this bill and shelving the discriminatory laws. I'd also like to acknowledge the work of my colleagues in Vancouver Kensington, Surrey Wally, and the former member for Vancouver Mount Pleasant, who did some tremendous advocacy starting in 2014 to shelve these discriminatory laws that have been in effect until now, once this bill is passed. So I just wanted to honor their work and to really bring forward the fact that we have had a history in this country of discrimination and oppressive laws that have had huge impacts on people's lives and well-being. The government of Canada and the government of British Columbia have gone to great lengths to keep its country white. The government has gone to great lengths to segregate people of color and has gone to great lengths, as we know, to oppress those that are different. I was mentioning that I am Indigenous. I was born under the Indian Act, which is the oldest piece of legislation in this country. It is the only race-based piece of legislation in this country. The Indian Act defines the powers divided between the federal government and the provincial governments. So I know full well the impacts of legislation on my human rights, and we know today that the First Nations in this country are not thriving, and it is because of legislation that is keeping their circumstances where they are today. There's been lots of talk about residential schools and children being removed from their families, which is no different than what the Chinese Canadians experienced when they were forcibly removed from their families. They built this country just like the First Nations, and in many ways the Chinese and First Nations have been paddling together since contact. And I really love that visual to think about the Chinese and the First Nations paddling together. And really what they did was they stood in solidarity because they were being oppressed together. They were being segregated together. Looking into the history books on this issue, the Chinese Canadians were subjected to hate crimes, much like that of the First Nations. They were forced to sit up in the balconies of the movie theaters, much like the First Nations, probably in the back of the bus, like our friends in the South. My point is not to go down just the path of history, but to acknowledge that members in these chambers made these laws. These laws were oppressive and discriminatory, and now we are saying they are over. Those days are behind us, which I think is fantastic to acknowledge that they are behind us. Last year, we had a report that spoke to truth and reconciliation and 94 calls to action. So first we have to acknowledge the truth, and then we can get to the reconciliation. There were a number of Chinese leaders that came in these chambers last week to witness the apology. I think it's fantastic for the government to apologize, but of course we have to acknowledge the truth. What their safety was compromised building the railroads, the subjective tax that they were forced to pay, the discriminatory tax that they were forced to pay, the hardship they faced for their families. And there were many years, there were decades that the Chinese Canadians experienced this discrimination. So I lift my hands to the government for acknowledging the truth of what happened to visible minorities in this country, and that we're going to hopefully, by repealing these laws, get to reconciliation. I would like to turn my remarks to something that I said earlier about the great lengths that the government has gone to keep the whites out, to keep this country white. Doing some history for this bill, I just want to read an excerpt from The Times on July 4th in 1913. To the editor, I have been an interested reader of the letters in your paper in reference to the Oriental Menace. I would like to ask you if it is not against the immigration laws of Canada for any person to pay an immigrant's fare into this country. And what is the penalty, if any, and are the Chinamen, according to law, supposed to pay their own head tax? It is pretty well known who pays both their head tax and passage money and also secures the Chinese peon a job when they land in the white province of British Columbia. You know, we don't have those remarks in our public media, but we certainly have those remarks shared in our social media. We still give people social license to talk with discrimination, to lead with discrimination. And so I appreciate that we are speaking truth and that we are going to hopefully get to reconciliation by moving forward with this bill. But there were a lot of remarks shared in these chambers that make me think about my grandparents who didn't have the right to vote in the province until 1949. I'm thinking about the Chinese South Asian community who wasn't allowed to vote until 1947. Indigenous people, Aboriginal people weren't allowed to vote federally in this country until 1960. So again, the government has gone to great lengths to suppress and oppress and seclude and exclude visible minorities. So I often wonder, what was the threat? Why were First Nations so threatening? Why were Indigenous people so threatening? Why were the Chinese so threatening? Why were Japanese people so threatening and South Asians so threatening? And so I really hope, as we move forward with this bill, that we get to the issue of fear. Because I think it's fear that drives the hatred. I think it's fear that drives the division in our communities and our cultures. There was lots of talk about multiculturalism and how everything is so great in this country, in this province, as we're celebrating our 150th anniversary in this country. But quite frankly, I think it depends on who you are. As an Indigenous person, and many people that are Indigenous are condemned. We're told that we don't pay any taxes. You know, we're made fun of. There's so many stereotypes that we're a whole bunch of drunks that don't have any jobs and all collect welfare. Those are the attitudes that are held today. And it goes back to colonization. It goes back to this history that we have in this country of trying to bring forward, civilize the Indian. Christianize the Indian. My friend here, the member from Hastings, talked about, residential school was about killing the Indian and the child. Right now we have more children in foster care than in the height of residential school, Honourable Speaker. So I am a person who wants to see the glass half full. I went to school really believing in my heart from a young age that we are all equal. It was only through society that I learned that I was different. It is only through going to school and functioning in our society that I learned a thing or two about racism. I'll tell you how my aunts and uncle experienced racism. They were told, why are you so black? Why are you so dark? My aunt actually had to try to bleach herself because she wanted to be white. That is the impact of racism on people in this country. So again, I honour the government for speaking truth to power. I think it's important that we speak to truth and get to the reconciliation. And I'm optimistic that we are going to get to reconciliation. Jenny Kwan and Ida Chong were the first Chinese members that served in these chambers back in 1996. It took a long time. I might add, but we are making progress. I became the first Indigenous woman to serve in these chambers, and to me that is a testament considering what my grandparents went through. The fact that they weren't allowed to vote, the fact that Indigenous people were discriminated against and displaced and put on reserves and given the worst conditions that you can think of. But things haven't gotten that great that we should pride ourselves in thinking that everything has improved in our backyards. We are one day away from the activity that's happening in the South. You know, people are coming out in high numbers, and I hate to say it, I hate to even mention the words KKK, but you know, we should mention people that are out there that are driven with hatred. And so when we think about these laws, we have to remember that it's fear that drives hatred. And that hatred drives a division, and that hatred leads to, of course, discrimination. So is the glass half full? I would hope to think so. It's 2017. This apology was made. I'm sure it meant a lot to the Chinese leaders that came here last week to bear witness, to see that there is something moving forward from the consultations that started in 2014, that it's more than lip service, that we are going to see hopefully action, reconciliation and action within our curriculum. And I would hope when we think about reconciliation that we don't forget the circumstances of Indigenous people in this country. I know that we're making some headway on getting some improvements into our curriculum for children in our elementary and high schools, but let's paddle together. Let's make that reconciliation together. Let's not make it about the Chinese and the First Nations or the South Asians or the Japanese. Let's make it about reconciliation and action. My dream, Honourable Speaker, I grew up with, you know, all sorts of, I went to school with kids from all over the United Nations. I see in colour, I dream in colour. I'm optimistic that things can get better, but we have to fight. I'm thinking about the people's lives that were lost because they were Chinese, because they were Native, because they were Black, because they were South Asian. And so let's not forget that truth as we move forward. Let's not deny our future generation an opportunity where we can have peace, where our kids can learn to paddle together, but we have to advocate for them to paddle together. We have to advocate to make sure that our human rights are going to be upheld in our backyard and that we are going to take a stand against discrimination. So as I said earlier, Honourable Speaker, the government has gone to great lengths to discriminate. The government in BC has gone to great lengths to keep its backyard white. And it is my hope that we are going to go to great lengths to make sure that we have a province that thrives with our multiculturalism, that we uphold our leaders. When I think of the Chinese leaders from the Chinese Benevolent Association, who really were almost an arm of government. They've been around since 1896 advocating for the Chinese community. Right now, we still need those advocates to advocate for Chinatown, which is a thriving part of Vancouver Mount Pleasant, for which I'm the proud member. So we need to make sure that we're paddling forward, we're advocating for that diversity. And so again, I'm happy to be standing here to speak to this bill, speak for the future generation, and really ask that all of us think about paddling together with that sense of diversity in our hearts. So thank you, Honourable Speaker.